In this video, we'll be focusing on writing a program for printing Fibonacci numbers, right? So consider that user enters the value of n, that is 10, and the first 10 Fibonacci numbers must be printed. So what are Fibonacci numbers? If you observe, the starting number, the first term and the second term is 0 and 1 respectively. So this sum of 0 and 1 is printed here, this one. That means 0 plus 1, that the result 1 is printed here. Then again, this 1 plus 1, the result is 2 here. Then next, 1 plus 2, the result is 3. 2 plus 3, the result is 5. And so on till 34. So these are the first 10 Fibonacci numbers. Right. So let us convert this into code. Now, let us write the code for this. So first of all, I need to consider a function, let's say PF, which stands for print Fibonacci, and it's going to receive a parameter int. Now the purpose of this function is to just print the Fibonacci numbers, right? I don't need to return anything. So whenever a function need not return anything, in that case we write the data type void, right? So this void data type says that this function will not return anything. So this PF is a function which stands for print Fibonacci. It receives one integer parameter and it does not returns anything. That's why we are using the void keyword here. So let us define this function now. So void print Fibonacci, in short PF, int n. So now if you observe, the starting variable, that is a, the starting value is from 0 and b gets the initial value, that is 1. So let me write here int a assigned to 0 and b from 1. Next, what happens if you see for the third term, the sum of this a and b, right, the sum of this a and b is printed here. So a plus b is 1, so 1 is printed, right? So if you observe here, there are 10 terms, right? So your term starts from 1 and goes till n. So I can just use a loop, that is for int I initialized to 1, I less than or equal to n, and every time the value of I should increment by 1. So once this is done, now within this loop, let me print out the value of a, because initially I have to print the value of this a, right? So print a followed by tab character. Now once this is done, I will just add the value of a and b and store it in a third variable. So I will consider a variable c and store the sum of this a and b, right? A and b. So I will take the third variable int c and add this a and b and store in this third variable c itself. Now if you observe, after printing the value, the values of this a and b must exchange. That means next time, for the first time, print 0 and 1. Next time the value of a should become 1 and b should become 1. So 1 plus 1 now 2, so sum of a and b is 2, so 2 is printed. Again a should become 1 and b should become 2. 1 plus 2, that is 3, 3 is printed, that is a plus b. Next a should become 2 and b should become 3, right? So did you observe something? B should get the sum of a and b, and a should get the value of b, right, the previous value of b. So that means we can write here, after adding these two numbers, I should write this statement: a assigns b, and then again I have to write here b should get the value of the sum of these two numbers, that is b assign. So c must be assigned to b. So this is how these values of a and b will move. So let me show you from beginning. Initially this a and b is 0 and 1, right? So what happens for the first time, due to this cout statement, the value of a is printed initially, that is 0 here, right? Next what happens when this line execute, that is c assigns a plus b, so c gets the sum of these two numbers, that is 0 plus 1, that is 1. Now next what happens, this a gets the value of b, right? A gets the value of b, and then again b gets the value of sum of the two numbers, and like this your values exchanges and we are just printing the value of a, right, every time. So I will show you once more this one. Let me complete the code first of all. So after adding these two values, let me write here the statement a assign b, that means put the value of b in a and then put the value of sum of the two numbers, that is C in B. We'll try to analyze this code as well. So before analyzing the code, let me run this. So let me consider here variable k in the main function, and let me read the value. So first of all, standard C out, I'll ask the user to enter the value of n, enter k, right, any value that the user wants, and here standard C in k. And once this is done, now we are supposed to call this function, that is print Fibonacci pf, and let me pass this variable k. So let me run this now. So before running, I need to compile it, right? So make test, no errors. Let me run it. So let me enter the value of k as 10. So the first 10 Fibonacci numbers, that is 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 21, and then 34 is printed. So let us try to analyze this function, because you know how the main function is calling your this pf function. Let us try to analyze that part of code that we have written, that is from line number 15 to 24, or this 25. Okay, so I'll just consider this piece of code here. So I hope you can just observe this clearly. Now what happens once the function call is made, your n gets the value. What is the value of n? N gets the value 10. Assume that user enters the value of k as 10. So n will receive the value 10. Now due to this line number 17, a, right? So your variable a initial value is 0, as you can see in this, right? Initial value of a is 0, and then b is your 1, right? Now we enter this loop. So let me write here I. So I is starting from 1. Now the condition is checked. What is I? I is 1, n is 10. So condition is true, we'll enter this part. So when line number 20, this line number 20 will execute, right? So value of a will be printed. So this 0 is printed as it is, done. So this code will print 0, this line number 20. Then when line number 21 will be executed, that is a plus b. So what is a now? 0. B is now 1. So 0 plus 1 is how much? 1. So c, let me consider the variable c here, somewhere here. Let me write c here. So initial value of c, that is a plus b, 0 plus 1 is 1, right? I'm just ignoring this part of code. Let me erase this part because it is already written. So your c gets 1 due to this sum of this a plus b. Okay, now when this line number 22 executes, so b gets the value. So the value of b is stored in a. So what is b now? 1. So a will get the value of b. So a becomes 1 now. Now due to this line number 23, what happens? C, what is c now? C is 1. So this b will remain unchanged, that is 1 as it is. So now what happened? You see, this value a and b, a became 1 and b also 1. So this got shifted literally. Yes or no? Did you observe? Initially your a was 0 and b was 1. Now due to the first time execution, when I is 1, for the first instant the value of a becomes 1 and b becomes 1. Fine. Now you see, the value of I will increment to 2. Condition will be checked, 2 is less than 10. Yes. Now value of a, what is the value of a now? 1. See, value of a is 1. So 1 will be printed due to which line? Due to line number 20, right? Now this line will execute, that is line number 21. So value of a is how much? 1. B is how much? 1. 1 plus 1, that is 2. So value of a will become now 2. Sorry, the value of c will become now 2, because a plus b, that is 1 plus 1 is 2, and 2 is stored within this variable c. So this becomes now 2. Now due to this line, that is line number 22, what happens? B, what is b now? 1. So this 1 will be stored in variable a again. So this a becomes 1. So it is just the old value, right? Now due to this line, that is line number 23, what is c now? C is 2. So this 2 will be stored within this variable b. Now the value of I will increment by 3. So from 2 to 3. Now what will happen? The condition will be checked. 3 is less than 10. Yes, the value of a will be printed. What is the value of a now? So did you observe something? This a became 1 and b became 2, right? So let me move this. Now a became 1 and b became 2. Did you observe in this code? Okay, so now a is how much? 1. So let me print this. Due to which line? Due to line number 20. That means print 0, then press tab, that is printer tab, then 1, and again now value of a is how much? 1. So 1 is printed. So 1 is printed here as it is, right? So 0, 1, 1. Now next what happens? Again the same thing, that is this line number 21 will execute. So what is the value of a now? 1. Value of b? 2. 1 plus 2 is 3. So c gets the value 3, right? C becomes 3. Now due to this line, value of b is how much? 2. 2 will be assigned to this a, so a will become now 2. And due to this line number 23, c, what is the value of c now? 3. 3 will be stored in this b. So you can observe again that a becomes 2 now. See, a becomes 2 now and b becomes 3. So again shift, right? So a became 2 and b becomes 3. Now this I will update to 4. So still the condition is true. So because this condition is true, again this line number 20 will execute. So this time what is the value of a? Value of a is 2. So 2 is printed. And in the same way like this, a and b will exchange like this due to these lines. That is your line number 22 and 23 is responsible for exchanging the value of a and b. So like this, your a will become 3 and b will become 5, right? Then your this a will become 5, then b will become the sum of these two numbers, that is 3 plus 5, and so on. A 8, b 13, then again a 13, b 21, and then finally a 21, b 34, and at last a 34, and your b, whatever is the value, doesn't matter. Once the loop this variable I becomes 11, the condition becomes false, and finally we come out of the loop, and hence we have this Fibonacci set of Fibonacci numbers from set of first 10 Fibonacci numbers printed on the screen, right? So I hope you understood that how this a and b is exchanged and how this variable c is responsible for the sum of these two numbers, right? So if you observe this part of the code, we can even return the nth Fibonacci number. So let me just comment out this line. So which variable contains the 10th Fibonacci number? Finally this variable a. So I will just return a. So instead of printing the Fibonacci numbers from 1 to n, right, I'll just return this value of a. Okay, before returning it, let me print this so that you can understand that for even for other values this program is working fine. So let me just run this once. Let me print 20. So you can see here it prints the first 20 Fibonacci numbers, 1 1 2 3 5, and so on. You can see, right, the numbers went till this much. So because my space is less, let me do one thing. Instead of printing by tabs, let me put here slash n. So this slash n is for the new line character. Let me run it. Before running, I need to compile this. Okay, no errors. Now let me run it again. So let me enter 15. So you can see the first 15 Fibonacci numbers are printed. Now instead of printing the first 15 Fibonacci numbers, if I want the nth Fibonacci number, so how can we modify this function? So we are expecting that this function should return a number. So the return type should be modified first, that is int. So instead of void, I'll replace their int. And instead of printing, I will return the value of a, because a contains the nth Fibonacci number, or you can say the kth Fibonacci number, right? So let me write here a variable. Let us say int p assigns this, and finally let me print out the value of p. So I will say that kth fib equals, and here let me just print this value of p followed by new line. So you can even print new line using this standard endl manipulator, or even using this slash n, right? So let me compile this program again, because I have modified this. Okay, so make test, no errors. Now dot slash test, let me enter k. So I want to see the 10th Fibonacci number, so hopefully 55. Okay, so this is, I think, 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10. So in order to get the 10th Fibonacci number, what happens? So what is happening here? I have to go one step less, right, in this case. Or what I can do, I can just write here k minus 1, right, so that I get the correct number. Now because what is happening actually, in this loop I have written less than or equal to. If you write less than n, then you will exactly get this number 34. So since it is going out of the bounds, so here instead of this, whenever the user will enter k10, so it will give you the ninth one. So if I just run it once more, before running it I need to compile it. If I just put 10 now, I'll get 34. So what is happening here, just because I have just provided here less than or equal to n, that's why that result 55, that's why we got that 11th Fibonacci number. So either you write here k-1, or one more thing what you can do is that if you exactly need this kth Fibonacci, just take this loop one step less than n, because once it comes out of this loop, this a contains your value of b, right? Because this b, end of the day, it extends here. That means after 34, b becomes 55, because 21 plus 34 is stored within this variable b. So it is out of the bounds of this number 10, because I have just provided the condition here less than or equal to. I hope you got my point, right? Now instead of this, let me compile this. So I have just removed this less than or equal to condition. So let me run it and let me observe the 10th Fibonacci number. So we got 34. So you observed very carefully that once we remove the equal to operator, so now the appropriate result is coming, right? So let me see that is the 15th Fibonacci number, so that is 37. Let me observe 20th Fibonacci number, 4181. Okay, why only perfect multiples? Let me write even some random. Let us say I want to see 27th Fibonacci number. So you can see 121393. So I hope you understood that how can we use this PF, print Fibonacci number, in order to print the numbers for the first k or first n Fibonacci numbers. So when we are supposed to print something, right, then at that time we write void error, because we are not expecting any return value. But in case you are expecting a return value, you should mention the return type and return the appropriate data, right? So I hope this program is clear.